ॐ भद्रं कर्णेभिः शृणुयाम देवाः भद्रं पश्येमाक्षभिर्यजत्राः स्थिरैरङ्गैस्तुष्टुवागुं सस्तनूभिः यशेम देवहितं यदायुः। ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः। हरिः ॐ तत्सत्। Vedanta says that bliss is our real nature. When we say we attain bliss, experience bliss, it simply means we attain our own selves. It is not attaining something which is out there. It is not experience something which is coming from outside. We just experience your own real self. This is not theory. We should remember, Vedanta is not only experiential, phenomenological. Vedanta is based upon certain fundamental daily experiences. The Upanishads, which is called Vedanta, are not, in a sense, philosophy, they are not theology or religion, they are profound answers discovered by the great rishis to certain simple questions based on their daily experience. That makes Vedanta so scientific and rational. They are not talking about theory. They are not speculating. They are not theorizing. They are not imagining. They are not visualizing. But they are asking certain very simple questions about our daily experience. When I said bliss, ananda is our real nature, a scientifically minded seeker may ask, this is what you say, but we feel that we are miserable. This is our real nature. Because every moment of our life, 100,000 miseries are knocking at our door. And with the past year and a half, this tiny little fellow called the coronavirus, COVID-19, has devastated our lives, and you say ananda is our real nature. That's absolutely wrong. You are only giving a theory from the books which doesn't tally with the facts. This is a very valid objection. So Upanishads say that I am not talking about something which is unrelated to your life. It says, when is it that you are unhappy? When you are interacting with people, when you are awake, when you are going for work, when you are talking and quarreling with people around you, you feel miserable. And when you went to sleep, again the quarrel came in a dream. Perhaps you are happy with some of your companions, and perhaps you are unhappy. But then when you go to deep sleep, what was their experience? Everybody in the world, east, west, north, south, India or Europe or America, whatever be the religion, whatever be the color and creed and gender, everyone has to say and swear ever that he or she was experiencing bliss. This is an experience. Remember, we are not talking theory, we are not talking theology, we are talking philosophy. This is a direct experience of everybody. And as scientists, we have to explain our experience. What does science do? Science takes an experience and then asks the question, why is it that is it so? What are the laws behind this? When Newton saw an apple fall, That is an experience. He actually saw it fall. He asked the question as a scientist, what makes it fall down and not go up? Is there any law behind this? And the human mind always generalizes. All laws are found through generalization. There are three fundamental scientific and philosophical principles through which human knowledge has progressed over the millennia. They are, one, generalization principle, two, classification principle, and three, unification principle. So I'll take the generalization principle, which is, as Swami Vivekananda described, the particular should be referred to the general, general should be referred to the more general, and the more general should be referred to the most general or the universal, and then it becomes a law. When apple falls, it is a particular incident, an experience of Newton. Then he saw a stone falls, and every object falls to the ground. So I refer it to a more general principle of falling, and then refer it to a still more general of the law of falling bodies, and then the most general outcome of this is the universal law of gravitation. That's how knowledge has progressed. In exactly the same way, Vedanta being knowledge not only of the outer world but the inner world, our daily experience. In Sushupti, which is deep sleep, every one of us is experiencing unalloyed bliss. Unless you have a disturbed sleep, which often happens, in deep dreamless sleep, which psychologists and doctors say is very rare, in 6 hours of sleep, hardly we have a deep dreamless sleep for a few seconds perhaps. Even then, at that time, your experience is bliss. What is the experience you have in deep sleep? Vedanta is analyzing your experience, not theoretically positing something or throwing some generalized idea as a theology. It's not a religion or a theology, just a simple scientific analysis of your daily experience. Incontrovertible evidence shows you that when I was deeply asleep, I had two experiences. One, I did not know anything. Two, I was intensely happy in sleep. Sukham asvapsam na kinchad avedisham. Sukham asvapsam, I slept happily. Na kinchad avedisham, I did not know anything. So I have two experiences. The experience of bliss, happiness, joy, ananda, and the experience of ignorance. Think of that. I'm experiencing not knowing anything in deep sleep. I wake up and say, oh, I slept so well. How did you know? You were not there at that time. How could you come back and say, I slept well? So from there, you infer as a scientist, there should have been somebody watching your deep sleep, and he recognizes you are having slept well and come and reports. When I am in the waking state, now talking to you and everybody is listening from wherever you are, virtually, I have the experience of I speaking to you. When I go into dream, I dream something else which is totally unrelated, or maybe in a confused relatedness to my waking experience. So the dream experience is contradicted by my waking experience. Suddenly I fly in dreams, and suddenly the moment I turn the corner, I am in Delhi from Calcutta. When I come back and say, oh, peculiar dreams I have these days. My dream experience is contradicted by waking state, and both of them are contradicted by deep sleep. So which is real? See how Vedanta is asking you certain fundamental questions, which is very scientific. Which one will you take it to be real? Many people say, oh, dream experience is not real. Why not? Relativity theory will tell you, from the point of view of the waking state, relative to the waking state, dream may be unreal. But from the relative to the dream state, waking state may be unreal. There's no scientific principle to say waking state is real. I think it was Bertrand Russell who said, if you wake up 12 hours in a day and dream 12 hours, which one will you take it to be real? You have to conclude, therefore, as a scientist, either all of them are unreal or all of them are real. You can't take out one particular experience and say this is real, that is not real. That is unscientific. Now, there is an eye which looks at the waking state, and there's a completely different eye which dreams, which is unrelated to this eye. And there's a third eye, which is me, which is in deep sleep, which doesn't know anything. So when you say I, which I are you talking about? Vedanta will ask you, wait. Oh, I feel very tired. Which I are you talking about? This is not funny. This is the actual experience. So Vedanta says, since you come back and say I slept well, there should have been one eye, huge eye, which is watching over your dream, waking state, and deep sleep. Let us call it the big eye. And you have I1, I2, I3, IW, ID, IS. I waking, I dreaming, I sleeping. So there is a big eye, of which these three, I1, I2, I3, were only different modes of the eye. This is scientific. You are forced into this conclusion. And Vedanta then discovers this big eye is the real eye. All the three are in the modes of that eye, and that eye is capable of operating as I1, I2, I3, goes round and round and round, discover that big eye, which manifests in these three modes, I1, I2, I3. This is Vedanta. When you go to that, you'll have bliss because you don't have any interaction. Why is it that we get misery in the waking state and sometimes the dream state also? Because we interact. There are people, there are things. Constantly I'm interacting with my mind. In the dream state, with my mind. In the waking state, with my senses. So when the senses and the mind are completely absent in deep sleep, I am in bliss. I therefore discover as a scientist, bliss comes when my senses and mind are suspended. But when they come back again in the waking state after sleep, again misery comes back to me. So rather than suspending them temporarily, eliminate them, destroy them. Manonasha, it is called. The mind should be killed. Don't commit suicide of the body. Commit mental suicide. Thoughts completely vanish. When thoughts are not there, I'm the most happy. This is my discovery regarding experience in deep sleep. So why not try it while being awake? This is Vedantic practice. Can I simulate? That's the word used in these days in computer simulation, for example. You don't actually realize it, but you simulate it. You simulate a model, for example, before you actually launch the spacecraft, you have a simulation, computer simulation. So can you simulate the sleep experience in waking state? Look at this question. Can you be fully awake? Your senses and the mind appear to be acting, functioning, but you are deeply asleep within. That means you are not operating through the mind and the body, even when you are awake. Vedanta calls it as yoga nidra. It appears to be nidra, but it is not ordinary nidra. The yoga nidra in which the functioning of your mind and the senses are completely eliminated. Others will say you are talking, you are eating, you are moving, but you are not eating, you are not eating, talking, you are not doing anything. Naiva kinchit karomiti yukto manyeta tattvavit pashyan srinvan sprishan jighran ashnan gachan svapan shvasan pralapan visrijan grinhan unmishan nimishan api indriyan indriyartheshu vartanta iti dharayan ब्रह्मण्याधा कर्माणि संगम त्यक्त्वा करोति यः लिप्यते न स पापेन पद्मपत्रमिवाम्भसा कायेन मनसा बुद्ध्या केवलैरिन्द्रियैरपि योगिनः कर्म कुर्वन्ति संगम त्यक्त्वा आत्मशुद्धये. भगवद्गीता 5th चैप्टर. पश्यन् श्रृण्वन् स्पृशन् जिघ्रन्. ही इज डूइंग एवरीथिंग. ही इज ईटिंग, मूविंग, टॉकिंग, बट ही इज नॉट डूइंग एनीथिंग एट ऑल. दिस इज द स्टेट ऑफ ब्लिस. सो वी हैव डिस्कवर्ड वेरी ब्रीफली that whenever there is vishesha jnana, there is misery. Particularization of jnana. I know this object, I know this man, I know this lady, I know this book. So when I have vishesha jnana, particularized knowledge, there is misery. And when I operate from my mind and senses, it is misery. So nirvishesha jnana, it is possible, although the Western psychologists and the Western consciousness people do say that there can't be any nirvishesha jnana. Jnana itself means vishesha, particularized and object oriented. We have discovered, not through ratiocination, not through belief, but by experience. Then how do you explain deep sleep? You can't wish it away. You say, no, don't worry about that. Scientists will say every experience has to be explained. You can't cut out a part of your experience and say, that I don't know, I'm not going interested in that. You have to be interested, because that is experience you pass through. And it's a huge experience. If you sleep for 8 hours in a day out of 24, one third of your life is gone in sleep. If you live for 90 years, 30 years you are sleeping. That experience, you can't wish it away. And therefore, we have discovered very quickly and briefly that nirvishesha jnana is bliss. From there you go back. That means vishesha jnana is misery. What is vishesha jnana? Coming through the senses. How does knowledge come from the senses? Through sparsha. Seeing is also sparsha. Hearing is also sparsha. Touching is, of course, sparsha. Tasting by the tongue is sparsha. And smelling through the nose is also sparsha. So any sparsha janita bhoga, enjoyment, is the source of dukkha. Simple discovery, Bhagavad Gita, 5th chapter, 21 and 22. Ehi samsparsha ja bhoga dukkha yonaya yevate. Adyantavanta kaunte yanateshu ramate buddha. A wise man does not delight in sparsha janita yoga bhoga, because that is the beginning and end. And dukkha yoni. Then what do? Bahya sparsheshu asaktatma vindatyatmani yat sukham sabrahma yoga yuktatma sukham akshaya mashnute. Akshaya sukha. Kshaya means decay. Undecaying eternal bliss, joy, comes from not having any contact through the senses. Bahya sparsheshu asaktatma. He may be doing everything, Prashyan, Srinvan, Sprishan, Jigran, but he is completely detached. Padmavatra Vivambasa, that is the central message of Vedanta and the Gita. Vindati Atmani, in his own self, Sukham, joy, it's called Atma Sukha. Sabrahma Yoga Yukta Atma, he is a Yukta, he is a Yogi. He is Yukta with what? He is completely connected with his own self. Yoga is not doing something else outside through the body or the senses. It is just connecting to your own self. Unfortunately, we have invested ourselves too much in the outside world, in my wife and children and my position and power, and now in my Android phone. My whole world consists in the little phone, and I am lost. Get back to your own self. The Bhagavad Gita calls it Atmavan, the very significant phrase. Dhanavan is a person who possesses dhana. Gunavan is a person who possesses guna. Atmavan is a person who possesses himself. What does it mean? We have lost ourselves. So Carl Jung, the famous psychologist, wrote a book, Modern Man is in Search of His Own Soul. We are helplessly searching for ourselves. Yoga says, connect to your own self. And Yoga Yuktatma Sukham Akshayam Ashnute. You'll experience great bliss through yoga when you connect to your own source of bliss, which you are. How do you practice it? Disconnect yourself from the worldly connections through the senses. Go through all of them. I am not saying you should not eat or jump about or watch television. Do all that, but disconnect yourself completely from them and enjoy the inner bliss, staying put in yourself. This is called in Vedanta Atmarama. Atma Santushta, Atmarama. Atma Krida, Atmarati Kriya, Vanesha, Brahma Vidambarishta, Mundakopanishad. Prajahati Yada Kaman, Sarvan, Parthamanogatan, Atmanyeva, Atmanatushta, Stita Prajnastadochyate, Bhagavad Gita. Atmanyeva, Atmanatushta, Atma Arama, who rest, finds rest in his own self. Atma Krida, who sports in himself. Atma Santushta, is happy and satisfied in himself. Atma Priyananda, the person who finds Ananda in his own Atman. What a beautiful name I got. I have to practice and realize it. So these are great ideas. First, go into yourself and find out the source of joy. Do everything, but stay put in your own self. I'll end with one example. We see the space walk. When astronauts go, they sometimes come out of the aircraft, but they are connected to the aircraft. And then they, you may have seen in the pictures, they move around and then see the whole world. If they are disconnected, they'll be simply lost and smashed. They again, through the rope, they go back. So be connected to the spacecraft, which is the Atman within. Then go out and watch the world and have great fun. Have great fun, but be connected, yukta. So Bhagavan calls it as Nitya Yukta, Satata Yukta, Yukta Tama. So the whole secret is to have 24/7 infinite broadband Wi-Fi connectivity with your own higher self. You experience infinite undecaying bliss. Sukham Akshayam Ashnute. Thank you.